and Steve to the stage.
You have just witnessed the dulcet tones of Mario. Give him a
hand. Yes! Mario?
Denver debut. No, we totally put him on the spot. So yeah. He goes, you want an intro? And he said, yeah, you do it. What?
He's very shy. We like to embarrass the shyest of our wonderful people here. It's always a good thing.
Yeah. Have you guys been nice to your staff? Okay, because they're the reason we all have a good time. We love them. Thanks, Mario. Love you.
No, don't bite them too hard. Just a little.
Don't bite them too hard.
It's like a little love nip.
Oh, I like biting really hard. They like that. No, you guys can't. We get to, but it's one of the perks.
No. So, I'm Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, and I was the voice director for Cowboy Bebop, the English dub version, along with playing Julia, because I was so madly in love with this man's voice, a Spike Spiegel. I thought if we ever actually see Julia, that he has been talking about this whole season, then I will play her, whether or not she sounds like this or not. I will play her, because I was so in love with your voice.
Wow. If I had only known.
No, you do.
Probably better I didn't, because I would have changed my performance.
And Steve, so it was my first directing gig, and I think this was your first lead?
My first leading role, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was usually ancillary characters or monsters or something, somebody who died horrible deaths or delivered horrible deaths, one of the two.
Yeah,
so it was actually nice to have a nuanced, fun character and kind of a badass dude in a beautiful-looking anime that I wanted to watch.
Yeah, which was so great. I remember them saying, so we have too many shows and too few directors. Do you want to direct? And it was my first time. I was like, Of course, the monkey on my back said, you'll fail. So I had to say yes, which is a good lesson. If you think you can't do it, try it anyway, because it could change your life. It completely changed mine. I became a full-time director, still doing voice acting, but I never did on camera again. And it brought me here today. So. Always follow those little things you don't expect in life, because you never know where it'll take you.
Yeah, just say yes and do it.
Yeah.
Especially if you're scared.
Yeah.
Yeah, we still do that. We still do things that scare us.
Oh, yeah. That's how I jumped out of a plane twice. Once on purpose.
We just got scuba certified. Once on purpose. Okay. I didn't throw her out. Don't look at me like that.
Yes, you did.
Just a little bit.
Just a little. Well, yeah, we both got scuba certified recently, so, you know.
Yeah, what's next?
I jumped off the stratosphere in Vegas. That's fun. You should do that. That's a controlled fall. You actually can do that legally, not just because I lost my house. Ah! You know, don't do that. That's bad. But you can pay somebody to push you off of a building in a controlled way, and it's really crazy. It's scarier than skydiving.
Wow.
Fun. Wow. Yeah. This is Fear Factor. Cowboy Bebop Fear Factor.
Yes. Except they don't eat live animals, mostly.
No.
Yeah.
No.
No.
No, although you made me eat bugs on box trolls. The box trolls premiere, they had chocolate-covered bugs. So I
that's right, you actually ate one.
I ate a cricket.
Yeah,
have you guys seen box trolls? Box trolls is
Yeah, they actually had a food truck where this guy served bugs. It was so gnarly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had to.
I didn't do it, she did it.
Yeah, I love trying different kinds of food.
Yeah, that's cool. So anyway,
so it's been almost 20 years since this came out. How many of you sort of grew up watching Bebop?
Wow.
And how many of you are sharing it either with your friends or with your kids, potentially? Yeah.
And how many of you wandered in here and you have no idea who we are and you just wanted a quiet place to sleep?
Yes!
Yes! Woo! Too.
Our people! We're voice monkeys. We do silly things for a living. Roger Craig Smith calls it hand farts. We do hand farts for a living.
No, he literally does hand farts.
He does hand farts.
So do I. Though. Yeah, Roger and I have hand fart choruses between lines in studios.
Yeah.
We're kind of known for that. Hand fart brothers, we create songs.
Roger plays Sonic the Hedgehog and Batman. And,
yeah, he's awesome. You know, he's dropped the hand fart beats, yo.
Yeah.
So we want to hear what's on your minds, and it doesn't have to be bebop related. I know it said bebop in the program, but we never stick to the program, so.
No.
If you guys have a burning question, just shoot up your hand and we'll try to catch everybody that has one. Oh,
yes.
I see a paw in
that
the back.
That is the greatest.
Two paws. Fire away if you can. Do you have a
if
a
we
question,
can understand you,
cheering?
Just with the mask on, that would be. Oh,
can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Not at all. Calling someone delicious is not sexual. Don't you think he looks delicious? You better say yes. Thanks for the question. Next. Right here.
I love a woman that can kick my ass.
I'm looking for a bounty on her. That sounds really weird coming out of me, doesn't it? I'm looking for a bounty. No, I'm looking for a bounty hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm looking for me. I'm trying to do some
bang, baby, bang. with the shooting blanks. Darn it.
Life is about self-discovery.
So I don't know if you guys know this, but we're like Spike and Julia are together forever because we are actually together as a couple now, which is awesome.
Yeah. That's my baby right there.
That's my baby. Life imitates art. So again, say yes to the exercise and you could end up with the greatest thing that's ever happened to you in your life.
Gosh.
Never know. I'm not saying that, Steve, but you could. Conceivably.
Theoretically, yeah.
Theoretically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You pick the next victim.
Yes.
So this is for both of you. In Rebels, who wants to have the largest amount of voice credits in the show?
Steve.
I want to be every stormtrooper all the time. We have so much fun doing that stuff. I love it. And Freddie and I fight for stormtroopers now. It's sort of a running joke in the show that because I played so many stormtroopers in the games, there are only three guys who did voices of all the stormtroopers in most of the games. And I always wanted to be stormtrooper number three. And so on the show, I always try to fight to become stormtrooper number three, and Dave Filoni never gives me stormtrooper number three anymore. It's always one of the other ones.
Yeah.
But it's awesome. I love doing the creatures and the dialects and things. That's really fun for me to do that stuff, and to separate it enough so you guys may not necessarily know, but you guys are so smart. You've picked out every single one of them, I think, by now.
And I just love playing. Governor Price is so mean and awful. And I was talking to Dave Filoni. I was like, she must have some redeeming qualities. And he said, no, Mary. Thrawn loves art. Price wants power. That's it. She has no redeeming qualities. And she's completely ineffectual. So you've given this person a lot of power, and she has no effect whatsoever. It's so topical.
Well, you have an effect on me.
Yeah. So.
That's all that really matters in the end, right, baby?
I know, but what's great is that that adds to her frustration, is that all she wants is power, right? And she sort of clawed her way up to become governor of Lothal, and everything she tries to do fails. It's just failure, 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 and it feeds her anger. It's really wonderful, and then it actually became a burden to play somebody this miserable. I mean, after a while, I was like, I'm home from a session, I was like, I don't want to be here anymore. She's mean. She's so mean.
Yeah, but you get all the mean out there, and then when you get home, you're so sweet all the time.
I know, but at Clancy Brown and I get to go after each other a lot, which is really fun. So it's fun. It's a good time. Yeah, it's so much fun. It's such a dream. I remember the first time I saw Governor Price, and Steve had been on the show for a while, and when we first got together was when it released at Comic-Con. So I was down there when you guys, was it Comic-Con or D3?
Comic-Con, yeah.
Comic-Con. So I was a part of this, on the periphery of this whole thing, watching it happen and meeting everybody, and then the first time to see your name in that light blue shining font, it's just like, it's a dream come true, for sure.
Yeah, being part of the Star Wars universe is like nothing else I've ever experienced.
Yeah.
It's like this gigantic, intergalactic, worldwide family.
Yeah.
And everybody has this level of passion on that show that I've rarely seen on anything I've worked on in 30 years.
Yeah.
And it's like that every single day that we go into the studio, so.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Yeah. Okay, who's next?
Yeah.
Oh man, that's kind of a humbling thing. And I didn't know that we were touching any lives at all until many years later when I started going to the conventions and people started telling me their stories. So it touches me every time. Every time somebody tells me that it was part of their childhood or that it got them through something difficult, it breaks my heart and fills me up again all at the same time. It's amazing, and it's amazing that it's continuing with a whole new generation too. And kids that shouldn't be staying up this late, and people that are falling asleep at work the next day because they're staying up late. It's amazing. It's the tsunami is just a phenomenon that none of us really expected. But I'm so grateful to be part of something like that that has carried on not only for 20 years, but has brought anime to a whole audience that otherwise may have missed it completely.
But the PSAs that Tom does, if you fall down, get back up. I mean, there's so many wonderful things because everybody's felt that way. I think we just get to a point where we feel like so isolated and alone and no one else is going through the pain that I'm going through. And then you realize that, no, there's everybody out there. It's part of the human condition. And what Toonami does is these great, this robot is telling you about the human condition and what it's like to be a human and that you're not alone. And whatever you're going through, reach out and seek out people and friends because you're not alone. I mean, I just think that's amazing.
It's been a very healing process for me personally because I felt every one of those feelings that we talk about in those inspirational pieces, whether as a child or in adulthood even, and to be able to verbalize that and know that other people are listening and that maybe by sharing this it might be helping somebody else get through it. I feel like I'm part of this amazing community and we're all kind of working our way through it together. So I hope we do a whole bunch more, and the plan is to do a whole bunch more too. That's the creator's favorite thing to do on the show too. Jason and Gil love to do those.
Yeah. They're amazing.
So thanks for watching Toonami. Only Toonami on Adult Swim. Yeah. We're back there. Yes, that's you. Yes.
Yeah, it did. Are we talking about the finale of it, or because a number of things happened to Noriko. I mean, it was amazing. I was going through a lot at that time personally when we were working on that show, and that show really helped me go through, process a lot of stuff in my own life by playing the character. And they didn't tell us, like, the funny thing about anime and about even Bebop is I would never tell any of the actors what was going to happen in the episode. It was more fun to see their natural reaction to what was happening to them in character. So for instance, Bang at the end of Bebop, I didn't tell Steve that was coming. I just said, okay, here we go, and beep, 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 here's a preview, and let's roll, take one, bang. Well, you do it. And I just let the credits roll. And I let Blue start playing and just come up, come up, come up, come up. And it was sort of life-changing. Noriko was amazing because she was unexpected. He was unexpected. It turned out that she was he was unexpected. And then all this stuff that happened in their lives, it was interesting because that was such sort of a group show. So it taught me again how to, reach out for help. And there's nothing wrong in reaching out for help and saying, I need help. And, especially when you're going through really tough emotional times, you don't have to go through it alone. There's no reason why you have to go through it alone. So yeah, it kind of taught me that. Thanks. Yes.
Don't screw it up.
Yeah. Self-doubt. self-doubt the minute you get something. You know, you have the first initial response of, and then the second one is, oh, shit. I have to stand up in a room with these people that's well-established and not, and sound like I'm part of this universe. And it's the pressure of that is overwhelming. And to just sort of, to have enough faith in yourself to know that you belong where you are, you know, that they brought you in for a reason, and that people want you to succeed very badly. So if you take all that into account, to find a comfort zone within yourself, to feel like you belong in a room of Steve Blooms and Vanessa Marshalls and Freddie Prinze and Tia and Taylor and Dee Baker, and just like, I belong here, not as an ego trip, but as a comforting trip to sort of calm your nerves. Because I think sometimes it's a great Indigo Girls lyric that says, you think yourself into a jail, which you do, your mind, you can really screw with yourself sometimes if you overthink something or if self-doubt gets in the way, you know. So it's nice to sort of find a place in within yourself and just like, you belong here. So do the work and have fun and don't let self-doubt control you and affect what it is that you're doing. Nerves, they're good. They keep you awake, they keep you alive, but don't let them run your life, you know?
Yeah, I remember that was a big factor for me back in the old days. I was scared all the time. Through 26 episodes in the movie of Bebop, I was terrified. And I kept thinking, you know, maybe they should have gotten somebody more qualified to do this. And she coached me through that. She taught me a lot. And I've passed that on to newer voice actors that are just coming into the fray, that the casting people who brought you into that situation in the first place want you to do well. They're on your side, and no matter what you think is going on the other side of the glass, that's where the biggest insecurities come up, is you'll deliver a line and all of a sudden there's dead silence and you just see the directors and producers going. And in your mind, you're thinking, oh God, he sucks. We gotta recast this immediately. We're wasting all of our time and money. And what is actually going on is, so you want the tuna salad or the fries?
Or let's rewrite that line. I feel like what they're giving us is so much more than what's in the line itself. Let's you know, and unless somebody says, give us a second, we're tweaking the line, we love you, which a lot of times you don't get, you know. It's like one of my jobs as a director is to turn to the actor and say, we love you, you're great, we're gonna talk about you lovingly. Goodbye, you know, and then.
Talk amongst yourselves,
because that way we need to get done what we get done, and they still feel comfortable, and because I really feel like self-doubt kills creativity. So if you're feeling like, I don't belong, I shouldn't be here, scared, your creativity shuts down. So if you've got a director that's being mean to you or that's like, can you just do it again and just, stop, you know, and it's just like, I don't know what you want and I'm shutting down now. So the being an actor is all about comfort and creativity and being able to take risks and push yourself out of your comfort zone. But know that you've got a net of people behind the mic or behind the glass that are there rooting for you the entire time, because recasting is a pain in the ass. We want you to do well, you know? We want you to do well. And the casting directors, when you audition, want you to get the job, because that means they can move on to something else, you know? So.
Yeah, and they want you to have fun in there too, which is some people who are so analytical about the process will think themselves to death. They'll think the joy right out of the character. And that breaks my heart, because we're all there. This is supposed to be the dream job. Once you book that gig, you're just supposed to have fun and do it and experiment and explore and play with your friends. And if you think yourself into that box where I'm not good enough and, oh man, maybe I should have done this differently or I should have studied differently last night, you gotta wash away all that stuff and just consider that this is a sandbox for adults. You know, you're 8-year-old in an adult suit in the best job in the world, and just have fun with it. And it's tough to get through to that point, especially if you're raised in an analytical mindset. But
especially if you're given one of the leads on a show, it's like, oh God, don't screw it up, you know?
Yeah, and a show as beautiful as Bebop too, that we talked about this before, that we really just felt it was our goal not to screw it up, because it was so perfect the way it was before.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sorry, I just have a comment.
Oh, hey! Oh, Lauren Landa, what do you got?
Ladies and gentlemen,
the amazing and unbelievable Lauren Landa.
I just wanted to say that I love you guys so much.
I love you.
And that you are so incredibly talented.
I'm such
Tell us your story, because we met before you had even started doing this.
Are we seriously doing it? I didn't mean to crash your panel, I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, serious, because a lot of people come up to us and say, I really want to do what you're doing, I want to get into anime, I want to meet people. We meet people all the time, and here is one of the greatest success stories those experiences.
I love you so much. Seriously, you guys are amazing, absolutely amazing. Oh no, don't bring up a chair, don't. No, this is the, oh God. I won't stay for long. So I actually have met these two beautiful people about 10 years ago.
Yeah. Was it Vegas?
Yes.
Was it Vegas?
It was Vegas for you. Yeah. But you.
In a bathroom somewhere in Milwaukee.
All right. No, I'm going to tell this story, and I'm going to embarrass myself horribly.
Oh, good.
This was during Peggy's class for I Dot and Jump. Yeah. That's when I met. So, I was a fangirl, still am, of both of these amazing people. Yeah, so I was taking a voiceover class at the time because I had an interest in it. And it was being taught by Peggy O'Neill, who's an amazing person, amazing actress. And we went on a little field trip to a recording studio. And at the time, I had seen many amazing shows. I had seen Sailor Moon, Dragon Ball Z, Gundam Wing, Cowboy Bebop. And this guy walks in and says, hi, how's it going? That's my impression.
Wow. That is what I said. When I'm hitting on the chicks.
And immediately my stomach just dropped and I'm like, I know who you are. I know your voice. And that's how I met Steve. And we sat in on your session and we watched you record. We watched you do your magic, and we just kind of hung out for the entire day, and you signed a postcard for me and said, I hope to work with you one day in the booth.
Oh my God, that's so cool.
And I always tell people this, that you have, both you and Mary have been incredibly so supportive of me and my career throughout the entire time I've been in the industry, even before I was, you know, doing anything, and just, you two are amazing people.
Aww.
Amazing people.
Chicks on the mail.
And it's, I love you.
And look at you now.
I know. I know.
Oh my God, no.
Oh my gosh. But you know, you guys were inspirations. You were incredibly motivational for everybody in this industry. You are two people that everybody looks up to. Absolutely 100%.
All right. All right. All right.
Randomly at Otakon Vegas in the hallway, and you were doing something for Toonami Faithful.
Toonami's 20th anniversary.
Right, exactly.
We were running around with a camera crew there just trolling fans. I didn't even know she was a guest there. I didn't know anything about where we were, what was going on there.
Exactly. I was like, what are you doing here? And we just did an interview, and it just turned into just us gushing. We were like, oh, I love you, I'm so proud of you. It was ridiculous, it was absurd. But I love you guys so much, and you are both incredibly just beautiful people and incredible performers as well. And I think everybody here agrees with me on that. That's why.
We love you.
Also, you have to tell them the story about you and Mary Cowboy Bebop and all that stuff.
Oh yeah.
Did you tell that already?
Yeah, we kind of did that already.
You're gross.
I know, we're disgusting, I know. The one, well, I'll wait till this is love fest is.
I love you too.
Thank you for joining us.
Seriously.
Lauren Landa, ladies and gentlemen.
Amaliva! Woohoo! So persistence and hard work and being where the work is and everything, you can have dreams come true. It's amazing.
Yeah, I remember seeing her coming in and out of Bang Zoom Studios from time to time, and it's just amazing what she's accomplished. And in 10 short years, for me, it was a much longer journey. But here she is traveling around the world and doing these conventions and creating memorable, wonderful characters. It's really great to see our babies grow.
I know, it's so fun. That's what's also a good thing, is that the voiceover community is an unbelievably generous and giving and loving community, because I think we realize how lucky we are, and we don't have to deal with The pressure of on camera, being on camera is a whole different, it's a horse of a different color, and to be in the voiceover world is just, there's so many people that are so, so supportive. There's John DiMaggio, who plays Bender, who's in Adventure Time, and we love John. He did this great documentary that's on iTunes. If you ever, if any of you ever feel like, you know, either investigating voiceover people or have an interest in doing voiceover, there's a documentary called I Know That Voice that both Steve and I did interviews for, and it really describes what the whole community is about, gives you a face to the voices that you've been listening to for probably most of your life.
It's a healthy way to stalk your favorite voice actor.
That's right! Yeah.
It's related to voice acting, but not necessarily to anime. I have a question. I read in the news about how there was a couple of voice actors who were, with popular video games, they're trying to pursue that. Like, if the game was super popular, that they should be receiving more pay than what they were. And I was just kind of curious to see, do you think that's going to go through more so in the future? You guys are going to probably be making the money that you deserve, which is a lot more than what you make. Like,
probably not.
No.
No. I mean, that's a small component of the current strike that's still happening.
So that's still going on. Because I haven't read anything else.
It is an ongoing process, yeah. I mean, initially we really wanted to get some sort of shared prosperity.
Yeah.
And so when a game, currently the deal that we're trying to have go through is when they sell 2 million units of a game in any capacity, then we get a little bump, and it's a very small bump comparatively. And
like that's part of a session fee.
That's a starting point. I mean, when games are making billions and billions of dollars and we make $800, and you know, we're a lead character in that game, it's not really fair.
Yeah.
So that's a small component of what's going on in the strike. There are many, many other factors that we're involved with, most including health and safety.
Yeah.
Just simple health and safety issues. And transparency, so we know what we're auditioning for, so that our agents can negotiate it or that we can prepare properly for the characters. I mean, really simple, straightforward, common sense things that the producers are just fighting us tooth and nail on. So a bunch of us got together and we decided we were going to try to do something about it.
And now the whole union is striking. So it's important. But we've got a lot of new companies to sign this new contract that we've put together too. So there's progress being made. It's just hard when we're trying to fight for something and the other side isn't budging at all.
And a lot of the people that are fighting for this are people who sort of make their own deals anyway. And there's a bunch of us who have been in video games long enough where we can get a little bit of a higher rate anyway, and the health and safety issues, like I won't do more than 2 hours of screaming. But by contract, they can have us do 4 hours of screaming, and under certain circumstances, 8 hours of screaming, where you can have permanent vocal damage. And so I'm fighting for the next generation of people like Lauren Landa and a lot of these people who are coming in now who are being abused in the studio, and two of my sons are doing voiceover work now, and one of them screamed for 8 hours in a session. I actually walked into the studio and I sat the head of the studio down. I said, you don't get to do this anymore. No. So that's where it starts. And we have to fight for everything that we get. And every single contract in film and television and every other area of entertainment started this way. This one is just 20 years behind what it should have been. It should have been handled a long time ago. We just didn't know that it was going to be this big.
Yep.
So thank you for caring. Performance matters.
Yes, hashtag performance matters.
I saw a little hand back there.
Yes.
Yes.
What's your favorite character?
Favorite character line from Star Wars Clone Wars? Oh, I don't remember the character lines.
Ahsoka.
I love Ahsoka.
Something Ahsoka.
Yeah.
I love
Ahsoka's
Ahsoka.
Awesome. Or I love Rex too.
Yeah. What's yours?
I don't know the lines though. I'm terrible. I don't even know my own lines. What's your favorite line? See, it's hard, huh?
Sorry. How about character? What's your favorite character? Ahsoka, right? Ahsoka's amazing.
Ahsoka lives.
Ahsoka lives.
We love Ahsoka.
Yeah, we do.
Thank you for watching.
Go to her
the show.
Universe. Ashley Eckstein's got the most beautiful stuff on her universe, all kinds of nerdware. It's so glorious and wonderful.
Yeah,
we
Ahsoka's,
love that.
Ahsoka sells awesome clothes.
She does. She does. Yeah, right in the middle there, in the glasses. Yeah.
So and emotional shocks you guys have had when you sit down in the studio and start recording and realize that something's going to happen to your character?
Oh, there's a couple of kids.
Bebop is certainly one of them for me. Another one was in Legend of Korra. Have you guys watched Legend of Korra? The final sequence with Amon and his brother, I didn't know. Dee Bradley Baker, who played my brother on that, we didn't know what was going to happen. They kept it from us. They wouldn't let us read the script until I think it was maybe hours before, maybe the night before. And even then, it didn't really sink in how traumatic that was going to be. And to the point where Dee and I have worked for many, many, many years in this business, and we've dealt with a lot of tragedy in our characters and whatever, and we talk about it, and it doesn't really affect us on a deep level. But those characters, we really became connected with them, and it took such a crazy turn there that we actually had to have a moment of silence on the phone. I mean, it was intense. It was really intense. And I personally get very attached to these characters sometimes. I'm praying to God Dave Filoni does not kill Zeb.
Only if Governor Price does it. I think for me, Naruto, Kerr and I, I played Kerr and I for a long time, and I directed Naruto for like 10 years. I just finished directing it a year ago because I've started now directing original animation. Tangled the series, everybody watch Tangled the series, it's so good, please watch it. Asuma is the love of her life. So I had to direct Asuma's death, and it's this long, torturous, awful thing with Hidan and Kakuzu, and it was just so awful knowing it was coming and having to direct it, and it was really emotional. It was like, and then going back in Shikamaru, just sort of looking at Kerr and I, and like, you know, and Noriko too. I mean, there was all kinds of, it's hard. You grow so attached to these characters, and they're just animated, but they become a part of your life because you bring a part of your life to the character. So it's not easy. It's not easy, and sometimes I have to weigh very carefully whether or not I tell an actor this is about to happen, to see whether or not they'll be able to handle it, or two, if I want that emotional response, which is sort of a weird, awful thing for me to do. Just like, I want to see how you react knowing you're going to die. You know, it's just like, it's a little sick, twisted director in me, but
But that's really effective sometimes, I think. You get that real, raw emotion as it's happening for the first time.
Yeah.
And you don't have to act when that's happening. It's like, what? Oh, no, man, that's just wrong.
So, being a 2D director, do you have you found yourself having more now that there's a lot of simulcast going on and dubs are being done pretty much at the same time as the Japanese version?
Well, I'm not directing any anime anymore. I've got 6 shows right now. And one of them is on, 2 of them are on the air, Pen-Zero Part-Time Hero for Disney, Tangled for Disney, and then there's 4 other shows that have not yet been, actually one of them has been announced. There's new, Boomerang, Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, I'm directing that, and then there's another and another, and those 6 shows, plus I'm directing for Blizzard now, so I'm directing the new Necromancer class that's being introduced into Diablo 3. What? Yes. So good. I get the male and the female Necromancer on Monday. I can't wait. And I've also been directing Heroes of the Storm lately, which is great to incorporate all these new characters from all these other places that I can't talk about. So I haven't actually done anime in a while. What's fun now is that as we start to get we're wrapping up Pen-Zero, so we're doing all this ADR on season 2, and we're doing ADR on season 1 of Tangled, so it's fun now to be like, oh, I remember ADR, you know, and I'm just like, oh, and the actor's like, I can't see the flaps at all, and I was like, and I'm like, I can, because I did this for 20 years, so it's kind of like getting back on your favorite horse, you know, but yeah, I keep thinking, oh, I want another show. I don't even have time for the shows that I have now. I'm really grateful. Very grateful. Yeah.
I miss working on anime though. It's fun. It's really good.
We still go in and do Naruto. I mean, I'm still playing Mei on Naruto and Kiba's mom, but the Mizukage, we're both caught the Kage on the show.
My back!
Yes.
Ow.
Jilted at the altar. Again. And you play Ow as well. Yeah. So I was
just looking at stuff.
Mention it again and I'll kill you. Yeah. So that's fun. I've been stalking, casting him in stuff that I'm in for years. He just found out. Yeah.
So, first of all, you guys are inspirations to me. I love your friends.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, recently, like on the internet, a lot of people like are getting into voice acting through YouTube and the other smaller sites. I'm technically one of them. In that case, I do voice acting.
Awesome.
Is there any advice you have for like smaller voice actors who are trying to get in?
Here's a good place to start. Go to iwanttobeavoiceactor.com for reals. This is a website that's written by Dee Bradley Baker. We mentioned him earlier. And it's free. And so especially for brand new voice actors, I would say start there because you shouldn't spend money on this until you really know that you are going to be investing in it as something that you're going to carry through with for a while. And this is like a $10,000 masterclass for nothing. So I would start there, and there's probably a year worth of material that you can go through there and start working on your skills and learning about how the business functions. And if you go through everything in that website and you still think that you want to do voiceover work, then it might be for you. And then he has information there on where you can go next and how to approach it. And the biggest concern for me with the people that I coach is that they don't get taken advantage of because it's the entertainment business. And there are a lot of predators out there. And when somebody hears that there's a market for a bunch of young people who want to get into voice acting, they're willing to spend anything. We go, okay, I'll teach you voice acting for $1,700 a class. And these people have never done a professional gig in their life. We want to prevent that from happening. So I would suggest going there first. Yuri Lowenthal and Tara Platt wrote a great book called Voiceover Voice Actor. It's also an excellent resource. And this is stuff that wasn't available to us when we were coming up through the ranks.
But you'd be surprised at how many YouTube stars are now being used in television and animation. Katie Wayne, who's an amazing YouTube star, is going to be on this, it's been announced already, on Billy Dilly, which is another show I'm directing. It should come out this summer. And she got her start on YouTube. So keep doing what you're doing. And continue to stretch yourself as an actor. Take improv if you can, and just have fun. Continue to just play. And if you think you can't try, do something, try it anyway. Just to see how far. You may not get to where you think you're supposed to be, but you'll discover something completely new about yourself that you didn't realize you could do vocally, which is great. So just keep playing and exploring and being creative, and eventually you're gonna need to be where the work is. So that's something to think about in future. But for now, just be as creative as you possibly can and go to iwanttobeavoiceactor.com. It is an amazing place to go to get information.
And the one best piece of advice I could give you is to do it because you love it, not to get rich or famous. Because chances are neither of those things would happen. And even if they did, it'll never fulfill you unless you're doing it for the right reasons.
Are you?
Am I doing it because I love it? Every. I'm half of one of those things. And it was a very happy accident. So
we are rich in happiness. How about that?
We are.
Hey guys, I've followed your careers for quite some time. My son and I did. He's but I'd love to see that you're a couple together now. It seems rather fair.
Yes.
So take Heath Ledger, for example. He had his character stick with him for so long that you couldn't sleep with his wife's head. Do you ever have problems like that?
No.
Come in, not a character, just that easy.
No, I can let it go. I think that maybe some of it sticks subconsciously once in a while. I had some horrible dreams last night. And
I think it's the altitude.
It might just be the altitude. I don't know. Yeah, I'm not sure what it came from. Maybe that stuff sticks on a subconscious level, but it's not a character by character basis. Because the character that came up in my dream last night was a character I had never seen before, and it was horrifying. And I may write a story about it. But it may be based on something that I've been carrying around with me for a while and I didn't know. But the great thing about voiceover rather than on camera is that we don't have to live with those characters for 12, 15, 24 hours a day for a long period of time. We go in very short spurts. We'll go in and do a character for 2 or 4 hours, and then we go and do 3 other characters on 3 other different shows in the same day, and may not revisit that character for 6 months.
Yeah.
So it's not something that we get so deeply invested in that it takes over the psyche and really screws with us, messes us up mentally. I can't speak for everybody, because maybe that does do that to some of the people. Yeah.
You're a lovely couple. God bless you both.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate that.
Yeah, I did play one character that was really awful, and it was hard to get. So every time I walked in, I was like, oh, okay. Put on the shirt, and then I was fine. But afterwards, I was like, get it off, go home, take a shower, Silkwood treatment, you know, anything to sort of get it off and everything.
Governor Price, is that who you're talking about?
Sure, yeah, that's her. She's a terrible person. Well, you always think it's so much fun to play the villains, and then you really play an awful one, and you're like, oh, this is a terrible person. You know.
Well, most villains have some sort of perspective where you could almost find a redeeming value in it.
Yeah.
Because in their mindset, it's for the greater good.
Yeah.
I don't know if Christ really has that.
She doesn't.
Yeah.
She doesn't. She's just long live the empire, screw everybody else.
Yeah.
And she's awful.
Yeah, that's tough to carry.
Wonderfully awful human being. Yay.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, well, it was actually for an on-camera. I played Pandora's granddaughter in Xena, Warrior Princess. Thank you very much. That's how I got into voiceover, actually. I was being hanged on a horse by the peasants who weren't so thrilled with Pandora's grandmother. So she was still carrying around, you know, the box with that let loose everything. There was a line in the script that said, "You have no idea what it's like to be cursed with this box." And I thought, that's gonna be nice for my mom to hear me say. But they ended up rewriting it or something, but it was really fun. I was, you know, but yeah, that show actually got me into voiceover. The horse I was being hanged on reared up and fell on top of me and dislocated my kneecap, and it was amazing, actually, the story, because Lucy Lawless came running up to me. She goes, "Oh my God, are you okay?" Because I couldn't get up, and actually a day player came over and pulled me out from under the horse, and all I could see were sort of hoofs coming down. He pulled me out. We were running, you know, or stumbling over to this tree, and I sort of wrapped around a tree, and Lucy came over, and she goes, "Oh my God, are you okay?" I can't do an Australian accent, New Zealand accent. But she goes, "Ah, you all right? I said, "Yeah, I think I'm fine." And the director came over and said, "Oh my God, that was amazing. I wish I'd gotten it on film." And Lucy was like, bam, just hit him. It might have been her husband at the time, or now. But year and a half ago, we were in Dallas, I think, somewhere, or Irving, somewhere outside of Dallas. And Lucy and Renee were there from Xena, and I hadn't seen them in years. And so I went up to Lucy and I said, "Hey, Lucy, I don't know if you remember me, but I was on the show years ago." And she was like, "Hi, oh my God, did we kill you?" So to see that moment where she actually remembered, and I was like, no, she goes, "I thought for sure that we had killed you. Oh, I have to call Robert to tell him that you're alive," you know.
She'd been carrying that burden around with her for all those years.
All those years, it was pretty.
Wow, that's awesome. I love that story. I was there. I had two really weird things. One was, it wasn't necessarily a line, but it was from a book on tape that we did called Cashmere the Flying Camel. And I did all the male roles, and Colleen O'Shaughnessy did all the female roles, and Brian Cranston was the narrator for this thing. And it was this story where they travel to these different lands, and they're looking for pieces of a mirror that fell apart, and there's a whole thing with that. But one of the lands was basically where all of the waste from human emotion, the anger and greed and all the terrible human emotions, would collect in this one land. And this guy's whole purpose was to be that entity that embodied that. And so basically I was an entire landscape man made out of human feces. And he was this big friendly guy, and his face would just sort of pop up out of this ooze. And just, And he'd speak, and he'd have this really deep voice. It was a very charming character for being a big pile of feces. So that was pretty amazing. And then the other thing was in an anime called Gurren Lagann. And I came in to read for the lead, which ended up being done by Kyle Bear, and he was amazing, which is more my typical type to read for. And then I see this character they've got in a pile over on the corner called Leron. I said, what's that? And they had a little model sheet of him, and they said, oh no, that's not for you. And I said, no, I want to see what is it? And so they handed me the sheet, and the first thing I see on there is, when you screw it in, give it a hard manly twist. And so I read this thing, I read it out loud, and I go, I want to do this, I really want to do this. And the casting director was saying, oh no, that's really not for you. And the Japanese client was there, and they heard me say that line, they go, loved it, and they ended up hiring me for Leron. And to the director's horror, one of our dear friends, Tony Oliver, I basically wrote an entire extra script worth of Leron lines that will never see the light of day because they're so foul. I could never just do it as written, and what was as written was pretty good. It was pretty rough, but I went like three steps farther, and my goal was just to make Tony squirm in his seat. Oh yeah. Man, it was so great, and Tony is this super respectful director who is highly trained. He used to be one of the directors of Power Rangers, right? And a lot of really classic anime stuff. And he's very respectful of actors, and he's always delivering the line and really trying to get the most out of his actors and make them feel comfortable. And I would just see him on the other side of the glass after delivering each line, and he would just kind of go. And we get to the end of the scene, and he goes, I'm going to need a minute. And I went, yes, achievement unlocked.
But nobody could filth it up like you. I mean, you're amazing. And do it to picture, perfectly sunk up. And I just leave it on the main track, you know, and we'll leave it in, like, for Miley. She would do Orochimaru lines, and we would leave in lines for for Yuri Lowenthal. You know, just awful.
Yeah. Crispin Freeman and I would do that for each other, too. We just leave these horrible bombs for each other just to see if we could either gross each other out or make each other laugh so uncontrollably we wouldn't be able to work. Yeah. So, yeah, that's a skill set that I have.
It's
useless. A useless skill.
Yes.
I see way back there. Who's that?
Yes.
Exactly what you think.
True love. What else would he be thinking? Ask me after class.
Yeah. Oh. It's so hard to ask about favorite roles because they're kind of like your kids. It's just like, how do you pick one, you know? Like, it changes weekly. It changes weekly. Yesterday it was Ethel in Tangled, and she had one word, Ethel, and that's it. But it's because she was premiering last night, so that's very important. Tonight it's Governor Price. Today is Governor Price because Star Wars 3 season finale is... and next week or the week after will be Motoko Kusanagi because Ghost in the Shell is coming out. And, you know, yeah. Oh, man. Don't you hope the movie's good? I hope the movie is so good. I just want it to be a good movie because, you know, the movies that animate a film have not always been so good. You know? I remember I got back from Italy and I had the worst jet lag and I was up at like 4 in the morning and I was like, what's on TV? I was watching this movie and I love crappy movies. I love crappy movies. And I was watching something going, what is this? This is awful. What is it? And then all of a sudden I saw the ball come on fire and I was like, is this Dragon Ball? Woo! Yeah. Eon Flux. Yeah. So I'm just hoping it's a good movie.
Yep. Monday morning, I'm working on Toonami again, so Tom is my favorite character this week. So,
yeah,
it's different all the time. If you have to choose between your children, you know, that's a tough thing to do. You have to save one of them, and you have two of them hanging over a cliff. How do you make that choice?
Sophie did it.
That's true.
Oh,
look how well it went
soon.
For her.
Way too soon. Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have a question as director of production and producing.
understand that these rather expensive. Do you happen to know any new technology that might be developed that will lower the cost of any school
Wow, I don't. The only thing I could think of is look at what South Park uses for their animation. Because what they are able to do in terms of sync and everything else, they'll record until 2-3 in the morning on Wednesday for a Thursday night premiere for South Park. So whatever technology that they have developed and used, this flash animation that lets them actually sync it up and do the mouths and everything else. But in terms of, as a director, I'm not really a part of all of that. I it's my job to translate what's in the script to the picture and make it look as close to, like it was animated for English as possible, and to get the best performances out of the actors as possible. So when you think about, you know, as I'm sure you know, being a director, there's so much that goes into creating a show. And directing is a tiny little part of it. Voice acting is a tiny little part of it. There's so much more to this giant machine that it all needs to work together, so many people, to create one episode. So, to be honest, I don't know. You know what might be a cheaper way until you actually get it financed by someone else, which would be the best way to do it, is get somebody else to pay for it, is to do what we call an animatic form, which is get some really good artists that you know and do a moving comic book with voice underneath. And that's what we use when we're doing pickups before we send things off to full animation, is we do something called an animatic. And that's a much cheaper way of doing animation. Check it out online. I'm sure you can find on YouTube plenty of animatics for even some of the most famous stuff out there. It's definitely there.
Telltale Games are kind of that philosophy, but on steroids, right?
Yeah.
It's like animatics on steroids. But I don't know if the public would accept that as a fully animated piece for something like an anime production, you know? So there's a bar that's been set, and there are finite costs that are incurred with the artists and all the production goes in, into that, so.
Yeah, get somebody else to pay for it. That's the cheapest way to do anything.
That's the cheapest way to do anything.
Get a sponsor.
How about all the way in the back there? Yes.
So, in regards to the voice actors strike, what can we as the fans do to help support you guys?
Hashtag performance matters. Support union games. I know there are a lot of non-union games out there, but support the union games, and when you like a performance, tag the actor, tag the studio, and hashtag performance matters. And thank the studio, thank the studios and the companies that make them. Thank you for these amazing actors. The performance in this game changed my experience as a gamer. It's not all about the voice acting. The guys that do the code that create this, obviously the machine behind all of this, is huge. But I really don't think The Last of Us would have been the same without Neil Druckmann, without Troy Baker, without Ashley Johnson. So to let them know that it does make a difference and it changes your experience of the game and how many times you will continue to play it and invest in that company's work is a huge help to us.
Yeah, and just by hiring a celebrity is not gonna make the game any better. And I don't think it sells better either. I mean, the data is pretty much there, so. You know, if the actors' performances are making a difference to you, then let them know. That's probably the best thing.
Yeah.
But thank you. And then from time to time, we do have a sort of a rally on Twitter with the Performance Matters hashtag. And if you see us doing that, maybe just jump in and retweet or whatever you're going to do. That's about the best thing that we can do at this point. And we'll take care of the heavy lifting.
Yeah.
We'll be out there, you know, with bullhorns and being stupid on the street.
But what you do matters, and what your input matters. I think we've been learning that a lot over the last couple of days even, but in anything, it's like, you guys matter, your voice matters. So get out there if you feel passionately about something, and if that is to help us out, that would be terrific, so thank you. Because in the end, you guys are the ones that are buying it. We're the consumers. We're the ones that are buying these games, and they're not cheap. It's like $60 a pop for good entertainment, but they're not inexpensive, so. Make your voice heard. It will help us making our voices heard.
Yeah, and we want to give you a good product. That's what this is all about. I mean,
yeah.
Especially with the health and safety issue, we want to be able to deliver you guys something that's completely immersive for you so that you don't even have to think about, oh, that's that person's voice. We want you to get invested in that character. And that comes with a good performance, and the only way that we can do that is if we have healthy working conditions to do that. So thank you for caring. I really appreciate that. Choose an answer.
Right here in the front, yeah.
Okay. So I know you were talking earlier about, you know, like having a Japanese client. So I'm wondering, when you're directing or acting a role that was originally written and acted in another language, if the original performance has any influence on how you act that character, or if you just try to make it completely original to yourself, not be influenced by the original.
It really depends on the producers. Some producers, like for Naruto, say we want it very similar. First of all, we want the script to be exactly like the manga. And I'm like, well, there are more flaps than it is in a cart, you know, in a comic book. We've got a lot. They're using more words than was used in the comic book. But Naruto, they wanted us to stick as close as possible to reflect what was in the original Japanese. Cowboy Bebop, that was not the case. They let us go, they let us do whatever we wanted. And because it was such a westernized theme and series anyway, I think it really lent itself. There's a cute little show called Glitter Force that we just did, and oh, yay, thanks. Glitter Force is so cute if you've got little girls, and they like, or little boys that like sparkly, wonderful things. It's really cute, and it's all about teamwork and everything else. But it was one of those where people of the fans of the original show were really mad because, like, you cut up Pretty Cure Smile and you made this thing. And I was like, well, that wasn't my decision. It was my job to take the edits that Saban had given us and make it funny and make it inspirational for young girls. So it really depends on the producer and what they want, you know?
We did that for Digimon too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, in fact, Digimon was so cut up that they had this little event at the end of each season that they did a karaoke night with all the actors, and they called it Dirty Digimon. And so there are a lot of things that they can show in the original Japanese that they can't do for an American audience.
Oh, yeah.
And they had some of these digital monsters peeing on a tree, for example. And so we would go
talking
up
talking boobs and crotch, you know, you're like, we can't show that in the States.
But after hours with a little alcohol, we went into a karaoke bar and we made new words for them. It was super fun. Yeah. I wish we could do that on every show.
We wanted to. That's sort of my dream, is to do something for late night TV. It was take a show that really nobody has seen or nobody will see, and it's sort of sitting in a vault somewhere, and just let us go to town on it. Yeah. Rewrite the whole thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Spike has... Oh,
Spike. First,
yeah. Spike. Spike, and then we'll come back.
I know you both said that Cowboy Bebop ended up being a pretty watching show for your careers as far as voice acting goes and directing and everything. And I know it's kind of hard to tell when a particular thing you say yes to is really going to launch you forward or bring you success. But was there any points when you're like in the booth or directing when you both kind of figured it out that maybe this is something that is really going to bring you somewhere special?
When the producers sat me down and said, here, we'll show you the opening in the opening credits. And I just watched and I was like, why are you letting me direct this? This is amazing. And I knew then that this was unlike anything that I would ever be a part of again.
Yeah, and for me, it was never about becoming rich or famous. It was just enjoying that moment, and I couldn't believe that I was hired to do what I get to do. And I think one of those moments for me was playing Wolverine for the first time, because I was a fan of the character, and just getting to go in the room and say, bub, for the first time, something like that. It was so fulfilling for me that I didn't care if it was ever popular, I didn't care if anybody saw it, I got to do it, and I could buy a Wolverine action figure and put it on my shelf. I was like that way, I was that way with Lego Batman. In the original Lego Batman, Batman was nonverbal. He just went, oh, ooh, and I got to do that, those vocal affectations. But I could also go to the store and buy a little Lego Batman action figure, so. My priorities were really, I set my bar really low.
So, it is all about the action figures. During the signing, I had a lull, and I was like, somebody brought me a major Funko Pop. And I was like, where did you get that? And I said, oh, it's online, FYAE, just put it out. I was like, okay. And I ordered 8 of them. Like, because I've never had a Funko Pop of any of my characters. I was like, I have Funko Pop, you know.
Well, now it's some of these shows have gone sort of next level, and we did a tour at Sideshow Collectibles recently, and they gave me this beautiful Wolverine that Mary actually let me put in the middle of the dining room table.
On a lazy Susan so you can spin it.
She's the best girlfriend ever. And yeah, so for me, that's success for me, just to be able to enjoy that moment as a fan and that connection with that character. Of course it's nice to make money. Don't tell my agent that I don't care about that. But the success comes at a much earlier stage and for very different reasons for me.
Hey guys, I hate to stop the party, but we got time for one last question.
No! Oh.
You shut up. We're gonna do two.
Two, okay. Okay.
You're last.
Okay, yeah, you got the final question. Make it a good one. Think hard.
Yes.
Yeah!
Yes.
Next question.
None at all. No, of course I felt very sad. I don't believe necessarily that he's dead. We never saw a body. But in the moment, it sure felt like he was. I was very sad. I mentioned this earlier, that to the point where Dee Baker, who played my brother on the show, and I had to have a moment of silence about it. It was very traumatic for me. Yeah, it hurt. It hurt. And you've been purified.
I'm on a boat. Yes, last question. It's too easy. Come on.
No, I never got to meet him. Everything was done. It's all done in Japan. And so by the time it comes to us, we're just kind of putting a little American flavor to it. It was literally our job not to screw that up. I would love to meet him someday. And I haven't listened to the whole soundtrack because I haven't watched... What was that?
Oh, no.
Right. Yeah. Oh, I know. I haven't listened to the soundtrack, but I didn't get to meet him back in those days either. And I haven't listened to the whole thing because I haven't watched the whole show. I've watched only the first 7 episodes like 3 times. Every time I get so busy that I haven't been able to make it through the whole thing. But that's a goal. I really want to watch the rest of that. And it's, I know the music is sick. It's really, really cool. Yeah, thank you for watching it. I love it. Yeah, that was tragic, dude. Well, thank you guys
so much.
We'll be back tomorrow. We got one more day.
It says that I have a solo Q&A, but Steve and I are going to do it together.
I'm going to crash it, yeah. So,
and then we've got one more signing tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. Love you all. Thanks for having us.
I'm on a boat.